Dear guests, it's great pleasure to welcome you at the 2014 annual lecture of the Scientific Council for Government Policy on the Future of Globalization. And we are delighted to welcome our keynote speaker, Professor Stiglitz. Great that you're with us. We're also delighted to welcome the Minister of Foreign Trade and Development Corporation, who will give a commentary shortly from the Dutch perspective. And we will also have opportunity for discussion with Professor Stiglitz, which will be moderated by Arnoud Boot, council member and professor of corporate finance and financial markets. Ladies and gentlemen, since the outbreak of the financial crisis in 2008, economic integration and global cooperation are facing stronger headwinds. What will be future sources of growth in the global economy, and what does that mean for Western countries? What will the place of the financial sector be in the global and national economies, and how can we ensure the provision of global public goods, and how can we reach progress with ecological challenges in our multipolar world economy? There couldn't be a more outstanding keynote speaker than Professor Stiglitz to highlight these issues for us today. He is one of the most influential economists of our time, not to say the most influential economist. I can just mention a few selected elements of Professor Stiglitz's impressive curriculum vitae. He is university professor at Columbia University in New York City, and a member and a former chair of the university's Committee of Global Thought. He received, as you all know, numerous high-level awards and honors, including the Nobel Prize in Economic Sciences in 2001, he has also chaired the President Clinton's Council of Economic Advisors and then joined the World Bank as a chief economist and senior vice president. He has founded and chaired the Initiative for Policy Dialogue, which is a think tank for international development. And he also chairs the OECD High-Level Expert Group on the measurement of economic performance and social progress. He was the lead author of the Stiglitz Report, the 2009 Stiglitz Report for the UN Commission on Reforms of the International Monetary and Financial System. And since 2012, he has been the president of the International Economic Association. He authored many, many books, and many of these, not maybe all of them, were bestsellers. The two latest being the Prize of Inequality, 2012, and very recently, together with Bruce Greenwald, the book Creating a Learning Society, A New Approach to Growth, Development, and Social Progress, just as his previous work, the WRR, considers this again as an impressive book of major importance, and it well relates thematically to the recent report of our council entitled Towards a Learning Economy. And tomorrow, Professor Stiglitz will present a seminar on his new book here in The Hague for a high-level group, and we're looking forward also to that. And very directly related to the topic of today, he wrote some books on the topic of globalization. For example, Globalization and Its Discontents, and Making Globalization Work. I think that's enough for introduction. We are very much looking forward to hear your presentation. Professor Stiglitz, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Well, it's a real pleasure to be back in The Hague. I was, the last time I was here was just a few years ago in connection with what you described as, it's been called embarrassingly, the Stiglitz Report, but it was the report of a commission, a UN commission of experts to re-examine the global economic system, not just the financial system, in the wake of the 2008 crisis. As I'll mention, and I should also add that your new foreign minister was very supportive, played a key role in that commission. Unfortunately, most of the recommendations of that commission would not have been adopted. And a lot of what I'll be talking about today are some of the ideas that we talked about then that still need to be on the agenda. So what I'm going to do this afternoon is first try to describe some of the underlying problems associated with globalization, then not to leave you just with the negative aspects of globalization, I'm going to talk about some of the big successes of globalization. And then I'm going to focus more narrowly on four very specific policy issues in the global agenda, and focus on one aspect of that of those policy issues, how they affect inequality and what might be called social sustainability. And then I'll conclude with some more general remarks. So let me begin by talking about the what I see as the underlying problems. The underlying problem is not so much with globalization itself, but with how globalization has been managed. And it's not always been well managed. We have, to put it in a way, we have a system of global governance without global government. That is to say, there are lots of rules and regulations, but they tend to be piecemeal. We have a treaty called the Montreal Convention for the ozone-destroying gases. We have another, we're trying to get an agreement on climate change, greenhouse gases. We have agreement, we have the UN, we have the IMF, World Bank. So we have a lot of global institutions today, but we don't have a global government. And so the result of this is it's a very piecemeal and often very uncoordinated. The basic thing, problem is that economic globalization, the sense in which the world has become one big economy, has outpaced political globalization, the institutions that we have to govern this economic process. And one of the reasons that this is a problem is that in our piecemeal system of global governance, special interests tend to dominate. So it's not a surprise if you were having, you know, it's difficult enough within our national governments, so let me say that, but at a global level, when you're having discussions of say, global financial regulation, the only people at the table are the bankers. And guess what? You don't wind up with good global regulation of financial markets. And this can go through each of the areas. With a few exceptions, in general, when you're having trade negotiations, it's the trade ministers that get together. And most trade ministers are reflective of producer interest, not the interest of society as a whole. I hope you are an exception. okay. And not to put a too fine of a point on it, in the United States, sometimes the main qualification of our trade minister, we call it the U.S. Trade Representative, was he was the president's campaign manager. So this is the way you pay back those who have given you large contributions. You may not think of trade policy as being payback policy and part of our political corruption in the United States, but it really is. And finally, the world has changed, and I'm going to describe some of the changes that have occurred, but we've not been able to adapt our system, even our piecemeal system of global governance, to these very large changes. And unless we do, I think globalization will be into even more difficulties. There's another way of thinking about globalization and why it's often viewed in a problematic way. And that goes back to thinking about more generally market economies. In the 19th century, we all knew about the problems of market economies, and that gave rise to a large number of social, political movements. The market economy, in a basic sense, was not delivering for large fractions of the citizenry. But then in Europe and in America, we learned how to temper the market economy so that most individuals benefit. But we have not yet learned how to temper globalization. In fact, globalization has exacerbated, I'll argue in remarks coming up, has exacerbated the problems of inequality. But at the same time, it has hampered the ability of the nation state, which remains the locus of where we deal with the problems of inequality. It's hampered the ability of the nation state to do anything about it. More worrisome, or equally worrisome, is today global rules threaten the ability of governments to protect the environment, protect the health and safety of their citizens, ensure the stability of the economy. And somewhat provocatively, I'm going to try to argue that the trade agreement that the United States is trying to push with Europe and the trade agreement that it's trying to push with Asia, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, are trade agreements which will have the effect of hampering, of threatening the ability of governments to protect the environment, protect the health and safety of their citizens, and ensure the stability of the economy, unless major changes in these trade agreements are made. And right now, I'm not very sanguine that those changes will be made. One more way of thinking about the issue of why globalization has appeared so problematic is that globalization has not only facilitated good things going across the borders, but it's also facilitated not so good things. And we know about how it's facilitated the movement of terrorism, but even in terms of more narrow economics, globalization facilitated the movement of badly regulated financial products. When I'm in Europe, I always thank my European audiences for buying so many of America's toxic mortgages. Europe bought about 40% of our toxic mortgages. And if you hadn't done that, all part of globalization, the economic downturn in the United States would have been much worse. So we exported improperly regulated financial system, and we exported some of the very bad ideas that underlay that, and we exported, in a very fundamental sense, the 2008 crisis, sharing it with countries all over the world in our generosity. But the more basic thing that the crisis illustrated so clearly is that globalization has made all of us much more interdependent. When there's a problem in one country, particularly a large country, there's a problem in all countries. And the basic idea here is when there is interdependence, there has to be some way of taking that interdependence into account. Economists use a technical term, there's an externality. When the U.S. does something, whether it's failing to regulate its financial markets, QE, expanding liquidity, contracting liquidity, all of those things have consequences not only for the United States, but for countries around the world. So that a well-understood principle in economics is that when there are these spillovers, these externalities, there need to be ways of taking those into account to make those who are generating the negative externalities realize what they're doing and regulating these negative externalities. But unfortunately, the locus of decision-making and the responsibility for addressing a whole variety of issues, from economic and social issues, remains within the nation state. And so this brings me, in a way, to the central irony of the debates about globalization today. When the period of globalization began, the modern period of globalization, taking down the artificial impediments to the movements of capital, goods, services across boundaries, citizens were told that globalization would bring new prosperity. But for many, globalization seems to have led to lower wages, incomes, and lower wages and incomes. Now, for an economist, this was not a surprise. One of the basic ideas of my teacher, Paul Samuelson, one of the great economists of the 20th century, was an idea called the factor price equalization theorem. The idea was a very simple one, and it's almost obvious if you think about really the simplest textbook model of the economy. If you had one fully integrated economy that was fully efficient, was working the way it was supposed to work. Fortunately, economies don't work quite that way. But if it was this perfect model that people hypothesize, then what would be the fundamental law in economics is called the law of the single price. There'd be the same price for goods everywhere in the world. That would be one of the great things of trade. But there would also be the same price for unskilled labor everywhere in the world, and for skilled labor everywhere in the world. And that would mean that an unskilled worker in the United States or in Europe would get the same wage as an unskilled worker in India or China. And the value of that unskilled wage would be closer to the value of the unskilled wage in China and India. Now, advocates of globalization usually don't point this out. They don't say, by the way, this is the model that we have in mind. We're going to have a fully integrated world, and you're going to get the same wage as the unskilled workers. They say you're going to get the same wage as the unskilled workers in India, China. You're going to have your wage cut by 80%. It's not a strong selling point. Of course, the model isn't quite right. Of course, I mean, we're lucky that it's not right, because the wages have not been equalized. What Paul Samuelson pointed out was you don't actually have to have full integration to get this result. All you need is to have free enough trade. With free trade is a substitute for perfect integration. And so the argument is that, and then he went on to show, that as you liberalize trade, wages of the unskilled workers in the advanced countries will come down. Now, there's been a debate about the relative importance of trade versus other factors and the decline in the problems facing unskilled workers in the United States and Europe. The most recent thinking is that while technology played a more important role up until around 2000, in the last 15 years, trade has become a critical factor. look in the United States, we've looked at particular districts in the places in the United States, and those where there has been more penetration of imports, where they produce goods, where imports have increased the most, have had their wages go down the most. So trade seems to be very intimately related to the growth inequality. But as if that's not bad enough, in most of our countries, citizens are being told to compete in a globalized world, there have to be cutbacks in taxes, and that means cutbacks in public services, lower corporate tax rates, less progressive taxation, leaving ordinary citizens worse off, both because they have lower wages and worse public services. And the result of this is that, whether for this or some other reasons, many modern economies are failing, and they're not delivering for most of their citizens in the same way that capitalism failed in the 19th century. In the United States, for instance, income in the middle, median income, is lower than it was a quarter century ago. So yes, our GDP is going up. Many people in Europe look at with envy at US GDP statistics, and it's nice that Bill Gates is getting wealthier. But in terms of the average citizen, his income is lower than it was a quarter century ago. If you look, and the impact on various groups is even worse. That's an average. So a group that obviously I empathize with to some extent are male workers. And median income of a full-time male worker in the United States is lower than it was four decades ago. At the bottom, things are even worse. The minimum wage is basically the level that it was a half century ago. So people at the bottom have seen no increase in their income for half a century. If you don't have an education, things are even worse. That those with only a high school education have seen their real income fall by some 20% over the last 20 years. So I don't want to say globalization is the only factor, but what we are confronting is a situation where large fractions of our society are not participating in even the limited growth that we have, and they may not feel they can do anything about technical change or the other aspects of our society, and that means that globalization becomes the brunt of a lot of the discussion. Before talking a little bit about some of the problems on the policy arena of globalization, I want to talk about some of the successes. And they show that globalization can be a powerful positive force. And on this slide, I've talked about some of the examples, the globalization of ideas like democracy, human rights, the globalization of knowledge that have led, for instance, to extending lifespans, and the achievements of global civil society like the Landmines Treaty and the debt relief and the Jubilee Movement. On the economic sphere, probably the most important example of the success of globalization was the countries of East Asia. This is the, 50 years ago, when Gerda Myrdal wrote about East Asia, he said the prospects were dismal. The likelihood is that they would continue in the mire of poverty in which they've been for thousands of years. But then they figured out how to take advantage of globalization. And countries like China, Korea, grew at really rates of growth that were totally unprecedented. Nobody even had conceived them. China has grown grew at 10% per year for 30 years. But the distinctive aspect of the East Asian countries was they took advantage of globalization in their own way. They took advantage of access to global markets and access to global technology, but they took a great deal of care in the sequencing and pacing of the reforms. For instance, China has still not fully liberalized its capital markets, and it was very slow to reduce its trade barriers. The results of the success of East Asia is that there is a very marked change in the global economic landscape. And the importance from a global point of view cannot really be overemphasized. We have China and India, two countries with 2.5 billion people, growing at historically unprecedented rates, becoming more integrated into the global economy, whereas before they were marginalized. And I don't know if you followed the news, but in September, China became the largest economy in the world, according to the new metrics. It's called purchasing power parity numbers. This was not an event that got any attention in the United States. The fact that the United States, which had prided itself of being number one, you know, likes to think of itself number one, suddenly became number two. But it may have contributed, that sense of no longer in the leadership may have contributed to the disastrous elections that we've just had. Just as an aside, the debate about these numbers, which are the numbers are very difficult, of how do you compare the incomes in different countries, the debate was a very unusual one. Americans always want to be number one, but in this particular case, China did not want to be number one. And so they held up the negotiation, they held up the technical committee, and they said, the numbers have to be wrong, we can't be number one. We don't want to be number one, because if we stick our head up, somebody's going to try to shoot it down. So the fight was on the problem was on the part of China. It didn't want to be seen as the leader of the pack. But it had already become the largest trading economy, and it had already become the largest saver in the world. And this is a little bit of an aside, but it's an important point. It is very, with China being the source of the largest savings in the world, it's inevitable it's going to eventually become the source of a largest management of savings. It's going to become a major financial center, and China is pushing a very big effort to make Shanghai a global financial center, and I'll make a comment on that a little bit towards the end. It's worthwhile putting all of this in a historical perspective. In 1820, not quite 200 years ago, China had 1/3 of the global GDP, and India had more than 15%. And then between 1814 and 1828, the Industrial Revolution, colonialism, unfair trade agreements really had a devastating effects. And this is just a brief chart to show the India and China, where they were in 1820, and how bad things have gotten by the nadir around 1970, where they were down together under 10%. And what we're seeing now is just a beginning of the restoration of a world that wasn't that long ago. Of course, we're living in a particular period, and we don't see it in terms of this historical period. But in fact, many people in that part of the world see it that way. So the result of this is that there is a new global landscape. A half century after the Indo-colonialism, there is a new role of emerging markets, especially in the aftermath of the crisis. a lot of the soft power that was been associated with the United States, the idea that it had an economic system that was the envy of the rest of the world, it was clear that that economic system didn't produce sustained, stable economic growth. Moreover, it was an economic system, as I said, in which there was not shared prosperity, that large fractions of the population were being left behind. So there is going to be a new balance of economic and political power. And one of the challenges of the West is going to be recognize these new global balances of economic and political power, to accept a new multipolar world in which there's not one or just two dominant countries, and to reform the global institutions. And that's been a major problem. I'll come back again a little later. Well, let me move on to the major theme I want to develop here, and that is the link between globalization and inequality. And globalization, particularly if not well managed, can lead to growing inequality. And this is important not only directly in terms of the effect it has in our society, but also indirectly. For if there's a perception that globalization has significantly contributed to inequality, there will be increasing opposition to globalization. And you see that going on today. And it's interesting, if you think about the Scandinavian model, one of the arguments that they put forward for having a strong welfare state, for a state which ensured that everybody shared in the prosperity, was they realized that they had to be an open economy if they were going to succeed. They're too small to be a closed economy. But that meant they had to get strong support for openness, strong support for bringing in new technology. And the only way they were going to do that is to make sure that the growth that they had was shared growth. And they have succeeded. Again, as a footnote, it's important, there's an important lesson, and it's really one of the main points of my book, The Price of Inequality. Inequality is not an inevitable consequence of economic forces. There's the same laws of economics in Scandinavia, on the two sides of the Atlantic. The same laws of economics work, but markedly different outcomes. And I emphasize this particularly when I talk in America, because America has the highest level of inequality of all the advanced countries. And something that most people don't understand, it also has among the lowest levels of opportunity. Even though people talk about the American dream, that anybody can make it from the bottom to the top, in fact, a young American's prospects are more determined or more related, more dependent on the income and education of his parents than in other advanced countries. But those two propositions are very closely related. Societies with a high level of inequality are going to wind up with a low level of equality of opportunity. And the fact that there are these different outcomes in different countries serves to remind us that inequality is a result of politics and policies, not really just a result of economics. In a way, that's good news because it means we can change things. But the bad news is that if you have a political system where economic inequality translates into political inequality, which has been happening in the United States, with the last presidential election, each candidate spending over $1 billion, and this most recent midterm election, the most expensive election on record, with economic inequality translating to political inequality, you get a political process that acts to preserve and extend these economic inequalities. So while it is politics and policies that lead to inequality, the economic inequality leads to political inequality that reinforces those economic inequalities. So what I want to do is, in the limited amount of time, I'm going to focus on four particular issues of ways in which we have failed to manage globalization, issues, debates about the policies and the globalization that contribute to the failure of globalization to work well, and in, at least in some of these cases, contributing significantly to inequality. The first is probably not an obvious example, but it's one that is very much on the top of the agenda right now in the United States because of a ruling of a U.S. judge, and that's bankruptcy, international bankruptcy. I wish there weren't bankruptcy in the sense that people shouldn't borrow more than they can pay back. But the reality is that it happens all the time, and there are good reasons for that. You know, there's risk. The world is very volatile. You borrow thinking that the price of oil is going to be high, and the price of oil falls. You borrow thinking that. Case of Argentina, it had fixed exchange rate with the dollar, and then the strong dollar meant its currency appreciated. It had a hard time selling its goods. It generated a large trade deficit, and its economy went into a deep recession. So, given the volatility of the world, just like firms go into bankruptcy all the time, we actually think it's a good thing that firms borrow. It's a bad thing that they go into bankruptcy, but it's part of the market economy, part of capitalism. So too, governments need to restructure their debts. And this has happened over and over again. In Europe, we thought it was a problem of developing countries until we realized that the euro had created the same problem of facing emerging markets and developing countries, where countries are borrowing a currency not under their control. And you had basically a sovereign debt restructuring problem here in Europe in the case of Greece. So this is an issue that comes up over and over again. The International Commission on Experts that I mentioned before said in 2008, 2009, this is a major lacuna in the global economic system. The IMF had said the same thing in 2001. But in 2001, the United States was not interested in creating a mechanism for restructuring sovereign debt. It vetoed the efforts of the IMF. But now we have the irony of a judge in the United States, and these bonds are issued in a particular jurisdiction, many bonds are issued in the United States, so that's why a U.S. judge can make a decision that's relevant for the whole international community. A judge in the United States basically took a very, very peculiar position that has the effect of saying that Argentina cannot, no one can restructure their bonds. You can't go into bankruptcy. What he said, and there's a technical clause, the periposo clause, but what he said in effect was that anybody who decides they don't want to be restructured has to be paid 100 cents on the dollar, even if somebody other gets restructured. So, of course, nobody has an incentive to restructure their debt, to accept a write-down on their debt. It means that if you hold out, you're going to get paid 100%, and that means Everybody will hold out, and that means there will be no restructuring. He changed the rules of the game. He changed property rights. It used to be that there was a rule in the United States, and around the world, actually, that you could not buy a bond with the intent of suing in order to make the capital gain. It's called the Champerty defense. But the vultures who bought these bonds succeeded in using the political influence to pass a law in New York saying you can't use that as to repeal that particular common law provision. The result of this is that sovereign debt markets are in a very unsettled state right now. Fortunately, the international community responded to this, and at the UN, they began a process to develop a sovereign debt restructuring framework, a kind of international bankruptcy framework. It was passed on September 9th by a vote of 124-11. The United States was one of the countries that opposed it. To use the colorful language, to give you the American hedge funds that bought these bonds at a very deep discount and are now insisting on pay, you know, they want, the Argentina offered them a 300% return on their investment, and they say, no, that's not enough. We want a couple thousand percent return on our investment. And those are called vultures. And that's been a name that's been, you know, they don't like it, but that's the name. But in the UN debate, one of the countries said, you know, calling them vultures is really an insult to the bird. Because vultures are an important part of our ecosystem. They play a role, and these guys have no part in our ecosystem. So they said it was an insult to the animal. Well, anyway, the point now is that the United States is going around the world trying to twist arms to persuade people not to participate in this process to try to create a sovereign debt restructuring mechanism. The argument that the United States puts forward is that just leave it to the market. You don't need a bankruptcy framework. And what's so peculiar about that is that every country around the world has a bankruptcy framework. If the United States' argument was valid for sovereign debt, why wouldn't it just be just as valid for ordinary debt? In fact, sovereign debt is much more complicated for restructuring than ordinary debt, because with sovereign debt, it's not just the formal claimants, but you have people like the pensioners who are claimants, people who are public claimants. You know, they have a social contract. How do you treat those? Very hard issue. But even in the U.S. bankruptcy law, we have a special provision to deal called Chapter 9 to deal with the bankruptcy of public entities. So we recognize that public entities are special, more complicated, and yet U.S. Treasury is saying, leave it to the market, i.e., leave it to the big guys to squeeze the little. Well, obvious question, why is the U.S. Treasury taking this position? Does Obama really care so little about the people who are going to suffer in Argentina? The amount that their vultures want would de facto be at something like 30 to 60,000 from every poor Argentinian going to the vultures. Does he really want something like that? Well, the interesting thing that's turned up and it goes back to the point I meant of the corruption in American politics, is it turns out that the key lobbyist for the vultures was a former key advisor to Obama. And so incensed was the president of Argentina about this is that she wrote a letter to Obama just a few days ago saying, is this true? And how do you explain your position? And so far, we don't know what the answer is. Well, that's one example of a problem in the global governance, which is serious and having real consequences. Because if we don't fix it, it's going to have a very big impact on the way the global financial market works, on the ability of countries to borrow, their willingness to borrow. If you can't restructure your debt, if you have a problem, people will be reluctant to borrow. So this really has profound impacts. The second topic I want to talk about is the failure to regulate. I mentioned that before the crisis, U.S. toxic bonds moved freely across borders. But since then, there's been a very slow agenda for re-regulations with, as I said before, banks having undue influence. Many of the problems that have been noted before the crisis have gotten worse. So one of the issues has been the too big to fail, too interconnected to fail banks. Well, in the aftermath of the crisis, how did many of the countries, including the United States and many of the countries in Europe, respond? They took the weak banks and they merged them together with strong banks. So the degree of concentration in the financial sector is larger. The problem of too big to banks, fail banks has gotten worse. Why is too big to fail banks a problem? Because if you're too big to fail, if you take risks and things turn out well, you walk off with the profits. If they go badly, the rest of society picks up the pieces. And so it leads to incentives for particularly non-transparent excessive risk taking. Well, as I said before, earlier, the basic economics of the regulations is very clear. Regulations are necessary to deal with externalities. With financial globalization, what one country does has large effects on the rest of the world. But with globalization and unfettered capital flows, there's been a race to the bottom. Before the crisis, Iceland and other low-regulated states won that race at great cost to themselves and the world economy. And that leads to the need for cross-border regulations. It's interesting because in 1997, that wasn't that long ago, the IMF, at its meeting in Hong Kong, tried to change its charter to give it the ability to force countries to liberalize their capital markets, to take away all restrictions on capital flows. And it was the worst timing in the world because it was in September, I was there, in September of 1997, it was right after the Thai crisis and right before the Indonesia crisis. And both of those were related to short-term capital flows. Well, the good news was that the charter of the IMF was not changed, but it remained a central thesis, a central point of dogma on the IMF, and they were very critical of any country that imposed those regulations. Well, the interesting thing is, again, how things have played out. One of the people who was at the very top of the IMF at the time, and a strong advocate of capital market liberalization, wound up being the head of a central bank of a country that was flooded with capital coming in during QE. And as the capital came in, his exchange rate went up and his export industry was being killed. So he went to the IMF and said, you have to change your policy. general principle, where you stand, where you sit determines where you stand. And by then it was clear to most people in the world that the IMF view on cross-border flows was wrong. And the good news, in 2011-2012, the IMF changed its position on the regulation of cross-border flows. So that's an example of where there's been a success. These instability of these cross-border flows is a major source of poverty, because when you have a crisis, it's the people at the bottom, it's the small businesses that suffer the most. But the glass is only half empty because, as I said in the beginning, we really have not developed an adequate global framework for regulating the global financial markets. The result of that is that there continues to be high levels of instability. And then that's related to the third problem I wanted to talk about, and that's the coordination problem. Again, this was one of the main recommendations of our commission, that there needed to be a global economic coordinating council. Our view was that the G20 lacked both legitimacy and representativeness. Legitimacy in the sense that the 20 people who are in the G20 were arbitrarily selected, were not arbitrarily selected, but were selected by, you know, President Bush in the aftermath of the crisis. Why is Saudi Arabia there and some other countries not there? If you look at the countries, some of them make sense. Obviously, the United States is going to be in the G20, but some of them don't make much sense. So it lacks political legitimacy, but it also lacks representativeness. The only country in Africa is South Africa. Nigeria is not there. So there are real questions about how they put this group together. And the Global Economic Council, within a framework of the UN, which has legitimacy, we thought was a much better approach to this problem. Well, the G20 did work for a while, one meeting, where the first meeting they had at London in response to the global crisis, there was a coordinated Keynesian stimulus to the global economy, and that stimulus worked, helped the global economy from sinking deeper into what so many people had worried about, into a new global depression. But since then, it's been very hard in the G20 to reach very significant agreements. The one area that I'll come back to a little bit later is an exception. The result of this is that there continue to be many aspects of economic policy, particularly of the large countries, where they undertake policies with large externalities which they don't take into account, i.e. they have policies which have big effects on others, and they don't take those into account. The most obvious example is QE, which in many respects, maybe I'm a little harsh in this title here, but in many respects was a failure. The benefits to the U.S. were limited, but the cost to the emerging markets were very large. You created this huge couple trillion dollars of liquidity. They didn't fix America's financial markets. The intent was to create liquidity that would create demand in the United States. But instead, the money went not where it was wanted and needed, but where it wasn't wanted and wasn't needed. And it makes perfect sense, and this is an aspect of globalization. You could move, you know, without, in a world of globalization, you can take your money and put it anywhere you want. The big banks were getting the money, they were lending it to big borrowers. They could move easily everywhere in the world. And would you rather put your money in a place like Brazil, or China that was growing, or someplace like the United States was stagnating? And the answer was pretty obvious. The money went to the emerging markets. And that created more inflationary pressures there. Meanwhile, even today, small and medium-sized enterprises in the United States are not getting loans. Lending to small and medium-sized enterprises is 20% below what it was before the crisis. We didn't fix our financial system. So the consequence has been that both when we instituted QE and then when we started to taper it, it caused large disturbances in other parts of the world. This is an example of uncoordinated policy. Since the major theme I wanted to focus on today was inequality, I should mention that there is a very lively debate going on in the United States now about the link between monetary policy and inequality. Now, traditionally, people in central banks never talked about inequality. And many monetary economists took the view that you shouldn't talk about inequality. The models that they used actually assumed that everybody was identical. But our new chair, Janet Yellen, has pointed out that inequality is the major problem, or a major problem facing the United States. And others have chimed in, including me, pointing out that, in fact, monetary policy, the low interest rates, the way it's been conducted, has actually contributed to it. Reason is very simple. What it's done is it's created asset bubbles which have benefited the very rich, but meanwhile has had very little effect on ordinary Americans. And that's why in the 3 years since the official recovery of their crisis, 95% of the gains in the United States have gone to the top 1%. So, the only thing that makes us feel good is that things could be worse, and we look across the Atlantic at Europe, they are worse. But that's not much of a consolation for the 95% of Americans who see their incomes still at recession levels. Well, I want to move on quickly to the final topic, which is the new trade agreements. And I want to emphasize that the trade agreements today are very different from the old trade agreements. The old trade agreements were, let's get tariffs down, take advantage of comparative advantage, and consumers will get the advantage of lower prices at home and from imported goods. So the trade agreements led to better ability to take advantage of global comparative advantage and consumers benefiting. And what you were doing is playing off producers in the different countries and really trying to get them to accept these changes and saying the exporters benefiting, the importers suffering, and it's that kind of political trade-off. Today, tariffs are very, very low. They're not substantial, except in a few limited sectors. And so you have to ask the question, what are the new trade agreements about? They're not about tariffs. They're about the non-tariff barriers. When we say non-tariff barriers, what do we typically mean? We mean things like regulations. But typically, regulations are there not just arbitrarily. Somebody doesn't one day say, I think we ought to have a regulation about banks. The reason that we have each of the regulations are there is typically a response to some problem. The reason we have food safety regulation is that Upton Sinclair wrote a very influential book called The Jungle, and people saw how bad our food safety was in meatpacking houses that they stopped eating meat. And it was the meatpackers who said, we want to have regulation so people will trust us. And the reason we have safety regulations, environmental regulations, is because we worry about these things. And this goes back then to who is doing the negotiation. The negotiators are the negotiations going on between trade ministers who, as I said, with few exceptions, are mostly representing producer interest. Well, producers in both sides of the Atlantic can agree on one thing. Let's get rid of regulations. Let's get rid of safety regulations. Let's get rid of all kind of environmental regulations. Our profits will go up. So everybody can agree on both sides of the Atlantic, this is a great deal. We'll make even a greater contribution to the trade representative. So that's what these new agreements are about. That's really the essence. And that's why I am very suspect about them. Now, in a sense, you can view these new trade agreements as an in-run around democratic political processes to reduce environmental safety, health, and other regulations. The producers have failed to get these reforms that they want, deregulation, through the political process, and they say, well, the way to solve this problem is to do it through a trade agreement with nobody really looking at what's going on. And that's why it's been so essential in the trade process for the lack of transparency. They don't want anybody to know. And one of the reasons why there's been such hostility by some members of the Congress, particularly in the Democratic Party. They still believe in democratic processes, with a small d. So a story illustrates what's going on. The U.S. Trade Representative routinely shares his negotiating position with industry representatives because they want to know what the industry cares about. The chairman of the committee in the Senate that deals with it wanted to know what the U.S. trade negotiating position was. And he sent his staff member, who's in charge of trade, to look at it. And the USTR said, it's none of your business. And he said, well, it actually is, and there's not going to be any fast-track agreement until we can see what's going on. So that's the intensity. It's now the debate in the United States is a lot about the democratic process that is involved, as well as the content. Now, the general point that I want to make can be illustrated by two particular examples. The first is an investment agreement. Investment agreements are not about trade directly. They're about investment. And they're supposed to strengthen property rights. And you could sort of understand that when the United States put that in an agreement with Mexico. You might say, well, Mexico, emerging market, developing country, doesn't have good property rights. But here in Europe, Europe used to think that it has good property rights. People in Europe used to thought that they have a rule of law. And actually, they do. So then you say, well, what if you scratch your head and you say, what is the United States demanding that Europe sign an agreement that's supposed to strengthen property rights? Well, the answer is it has nothing to do with property rights. It's not about strengthening property rights. It's about deregulation. And the example that I used to bring it out, perhaps a little bit, and particularly when I talk in Asia, I don't know if you remember the Opium War, most important, what?
We were in it.
You were in it, okay. So you were on the winning side of the war. In China, when I talk about this, they were on the losing side of the war, and they don't remember it very fondly. It was to deal with an issue of 19th century globalization. There was a trade imbalance. probably not how it's talked about in the textbooks here, but there's a trade imbalance. China had a lot of things that the West wanted, like China, porcelain. And the West had very little that China wanted. So there were a lot more imports from China than exports, trade imbalance, and we all know that's a problem. So then the West figured out a great solution. India turns out to be a good place for growing poppy, maybe not quite as good as Afghanistan, but anyway, they discovered they could send the ships that were going to China could pick up opium and deliver it to China. And as we teach in our business school, the best products are those where you get repeat sales. And even better is when you can guarantee the repeat sales by addiction. So opium has a lot of good properties from a marketing point of view. So they developed this market, and then the Chinese government had the amazing audacity to say that they thought that was not good for China. And they tried to put a trade restriction. And we thought, you know, this interferes with basic economic rights. So Netherlands and a group of other countries, with the support of the United States, waged two wars and to ensure that we had open markets, free trade. Well, now the United States is waging what I call the new opium war. Under these investment treaties, a provision very similar to one that is in the proposed in the agreement with Europe, is in an agreement with Uruguay. And Uruguay has a model law on cigarettes. It's figured out that cigarettes kill, not good for your health. And it's trying to restrict the sale of cigarettes. WHO says regulations are great, you know, according to the best standards. And Philip Morris is suing under the investment agreement. And the U.S. says this is, you know, basic human right of American firms to sell products that kill in other countries. So that's what these investment agreements that some of your people are trying to sell in Europe. Another example are financial market regulations. One of the things that we should have learned is, as I said before, that unregulated financial markets can be very unstable. Cross-border flows can be very destabilizing, and the IMF has recommended that you have these restrictions. Well, for some reason, nobody has told the USTR that we had a crisis in 2008 and that there's been a change in worldview on these issues, and they are continuing to insist as part of the investment agreements, no restrictions. And these have real effects. I was down in Chile in 2010 in the midst of QE, capital was coming in, and the U.S. had put this kind of a provision in their investment agreement with Chile, and they were inhibited from stopping the surge of money coming in, leading to an increase in the price of their exchange rate and killing their export industry. Well, the second example is access to life-saving medicines. I think you all know about that the U.S. is... I was on a commission, the World Commission on the Social Dimensions of Globalization, and the one recommendation that we got support, it was government, business, and academics, it was a cross-section. We all said we need to go towards TRIPS minus to take care of this access to health. And what are the U.S. trying to do? TRIPS plus. To make it more and more difficult. In the discussion, I can talk a little bit about some of the tricks that the U.S. is doing to make access to healthcare more difficult. Well, I want to emphasize that while globalization has contributed to inequality, it has impaired the ability to address it. And that's partly because money can move so easily around the world, it can avoid paying taxes. And this has been a big subject of discussion recently in Europe, with Luxembourg, Ireland have been exposed to as centers of tax avoidance. These are not the Cayman Islands we're talking about. And we have some of the major American firms like Apple and Google using that same ingenuity that produced these wonderful products to avoid paying taxes. So Apple has become the poster child. Somehow a few people in Ireland are the source of all the value added, all the profits of this vast company. And so they claim that all the profits are generated in Ireland, and that's why they shouldn't have to pay any taxes in America. They're perfectly willing to use intellectual property in the United States, to use ideas that are generated by the U.S. government and paid for by the U.S. government. They're willing to take, but they're not willing to give back. So let me quickly conclude. Globalization has brought many benefits, including helping many people in the emerging markets to close the gap between themselves and advanced countries, moving hundreds of millions of people out of poverty, but has contributed inequality within developed countries and inhibited their ability to address these inequalities. As I said, the results are not inevitable. It's really the way we've managed globalization in the absence of an effective system of global governance. The unbalanced globalization has resulted in a whole set of a host of other problems that I've hinted at. The excesses of financial globalization and deregulation have contributed to global instability. They've imposed threats to the environment, and especially the new trade investment agreements pose potential threats to the regulations that play an important role in tempering the excesses of the market economy. I want to end on a hopeful note. I think globalization can be managed better in ways in which the adverse effects can be mitigated while retaining the positive benefits, but this will require major changes in the governance of globalization. And as I said, the core issue is that it's managed for the special interests of certain sectors within certain countries, with undue influence of a flawed ideology, what I've referred to as market fundamentalism, which was fashionable in the era of the rapid expansion of globalization, but has since been widely discredited. Unfortunately, changing governance is difficult. As an example, the G20 agreed that there ought to be a change in the governance of the IMF and World Bank, and the U.S. Has basically reneged on that agreement. And so it's made it very difficult. But there are some changes on their way. New institutions to reflect better interests and concerns of developing countries, such as the BRICS Bank, trying to say we could, to put it, to highlight the way that the world today is different, the BRICS, five countries, have their combined income today is larger than the advanced countries' income was at the time the World Bank and IMF were founded. So they have the resources to start an institution of their own, and they have. Now, the interesting thing is that was ratified and is now being set up in Shanghai. China also proposed creating a infrastructure bank. The needs for infrastructure are in the trillions of dollars. The World Bank and the regional development banks are inhibited because of a lack of capital. They would like to be recapitalized, but U.S. Congress won't provide the additional capital. And under the rules, if the United States won't provide the additional capital, no one else can. So the old institutions are stymied. But meanwhile, the United States is now going around trying to block the Asian Infrastructure Fund. It's trying to twist the arms of the countries in Asia, like Indonesia, not to join. So while it's not willing to make a contribution itself, it's taking on a destructive role in allowing Asia to go ahead on its own. Now, totally understandable, it doesn't want to see its influence diminish. But this is what I said in the very beginning. Unless the West comes to terms with the new geopolitics, it won't be able to play the constructive role that is going to be necessary to create the kind of world that we want. So the good news is that there is a new awareness of the problems. For instance, civil society opposition around the world to the new trade agreements. And I've visited, particularly in TPP agreements, many of the countries. There's strong opposition. And perhaps most hopefully, there's new agreement on the importance of equality, new evidence on the importance of social sustainability, the IMF studies showing that inequality is bad for economic performance, and new studies like my own book, The Price of Inequality, arguing that we can have better economic performance and greater equality. So the challenge for us is now to borrow the word I used before, to temper globalization, to manage it, to reconceive globalization in ways that it's not just serving a few special interests, but that it can be rechanneled to serve the interests of the vast majority of our citizens. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Stiglitz, for your fascinating speech with two important concluding remarks that globalization can be managed better and that changes are underway. And you also underlined it with some appropriate urgency. Thank you so much. Some of the points will certainly return in the discussion we will have shortly. But before coming to that discussion, I would like to invite our Minister of Foreign Trade and Development Cooperation to give her commentary. She is also responsible for the Dutch international policy on environment and climate, which makes it to a very intriguing package in the field of globalization. May I invite the minister.
Good afternoon to all of you, ladies, gentlemen, friends, Professor Stiglitz. Let me just start by a very personal note, which is not very relevant to many of you, but very relevant to me. And since I'm standing here and this is about change, about combating inequality, I thought I want to share it with you. My mother was born in 1929. She was the 11th child in a family of 12. Very happy, very large family, not very rich. They were farmers. And when my mom was 11, her dad said, well, dear, you have to quit school because, you know, we need you to work with us on the farm. And she did. And so that was all the education that she got. Now, I'm standing here. This morning, I WhatsApped with my daughter. She's 21. And I said, you know, what are you going to do today? She said, oh, yeah, great, great. I will have a wonderful day because this afternoon I'm invited to listen to a lecture of Thomas Piketty. I said, yeah, great. She said, what are you going to do? I said, well, I've been asked to reflect on the words of a Nobel Prize laureate, Professor Stiglitz, on globalization. So change can happen, I would like to say. Professor Stiglitz, I have some reflections on what you've been saying, and I will not go into the opium wars. I once wrote an essay about that during my studies. We were part of this, let me say, coalition on opium, and it must have been a very important role because it was a very lengthy essay, but not much more I can remember. But anyway, I'll look it up and see if there's anything relevant to share with you. I will talk about TTIP and trade agreements, obviously. Very relevant, I think, to this debate, and also very relevant to many of the debates that I have in Parliament, but also with some of you and some others, and rightly so. It's, I think, an issue that needs to be debated more than it has been until now, for all the good reasons. But I will talk about inclusive growth, I will talk about global governance, on international trade, on tax avoidance, and I will also end on a hopeful note. And you will notice, Professor, we converge sometimes, we diverge sometimes. Sometimes I'm less diplomatic and sometimes I'm more diplomatic. So let's go. Of course, like many of you, I read reports by the United Nations, the World Bank, IMF, their Dutch counterparts, the WRR. I read the books of Professor Stiglitz and others, and I keep up with the latest economic theories. And happily, economics and the way that we deal with economics is at the heart of many debates now. Now, all these books and essays give me the facts and the intellectual framework to frame those facts. But what really shapes my image of the world and the state of the world and the state of globalization are the trips that I make and the people that I talk to, and of course, literature. When I think of globalization, I think first of images before I think about the facts. Powerful images coming from How to Get Filthy Rich in Rising Asia, a wonderful book by a Pakistani writer, Mohsin Hamid. You should all read this book. We meet the nameless main character hunched up under his mother's bed, shivering with hepatitis E. And Hamid writes, "It kills only about 1 in 50, so you're likely to recover." And our character does recover. He moves from his poor rural village to the city, and he works his way out of poverty, with jobs as a video delivery boy, a salesman, and eventually self-employed, he does indeed manage to become filthy rich. Later on in his life, he loses his wealth, but he finds love. We're not going to get into that part. For me, the great thing about this book, besides it's beautifully written, is Hamid's convincing portrait of the new Asia, full of opportunity, but also full of injustice and completely merciless. The book is fiction, but the main character stands for a new generation of Asians, Africans, and South Americans, people who were once very poor in countries that once were very poor. And thanks to the economic growth in their country, they now have a prospect of a better life than their parents, just like I. I meet many young people from this generation during my travels in Brazil, Bangladesh, yesterday in India. And they are growing up in a world where extreme poverty has halved over the last 30 years. And this generation may even see the day when hunger is banished forever, a prospect that I never dared dream of at that age. As encouraging is that in 2012, over 60% of all foreign investment went to emerging economies. Access to international markets and technology through trade and investment have proved to be crucial for economic development. I hear it time and again on my travels. People would rather have Dutch investment instead of Dutch aid. The market is vital in the fight against poverty, but of course, there's a but. The market is no cure-all. It does not guarantee a prosperous society for all. By no means everyone has benefited from it as we see it. Excessive liberalization of international financial markets has caused terrible misery. The structural faults in the financial sector, complete with the perverse incentives like bonuses that have risen out of all proportion, have cost society dearly. Wouter Bos, a former leader of my party, was Minister of Finance when the financial crisis hit. He concluded that it was more than simply a financial crisis. It was also a crisis of values, a crisis of the balance between excess and moderation, between the long and the short term, between status seeking and service to society, between recklessness and responsibilities. And I guess Professor Stiglitz, he was also referring to what you would call the vultures. That crisis that continues to this day. Tax avoidance by multinationals runs into billions of euros every year, as you mentioned. Developing countries may lose millions of euros a year from the unintended use of Dutch tax treaties alone. Some companies navigate from loophole to tax haven through the network of international tax treaties. And the winner is the one that manages to pay as little tax as possible. Let me say to companies like these, you are tomorrow's losers. You will have to explain why you pay little or no tax in the places where you make your profits, using local labor and natural resources, infrastructure and other facilities paid by those who did pay their taxes. You cannot justify this. Stop it before it's too late. And so I call upon those companies to review their tax evasion policies. Pay taxes and pay them where you generate your profits. Likewise, I call upon countries to review their tax treaties with developing countries. The Netherlands is cooperating actively on the OECD action plan on base erosion and profit shifting. And we are currently reviewing our 23 tax treaties with developing countries to reduce any negative effects. Let me get to the main character of Moshin Hamid's book. He does not necessarily strike me as a social democrat, but I fully agree when he dryly says, there are forks in the road to wealth that have nothing to do with choice or desire or effort. We've seen how international markets push wages down, particularly those of the most vulnerable. We have learned about land grabbing by huge agricultural firms in developing countries where they buy land to grow cash crops on large scale for export, driving smallholders off their land. And we've seen the deplorable conditions some people have to work in, and the textile industry proves that. The collapse of the Rana Plaza textile factory in Bangladesh was globalization at its ugliest. In short, I would say globalization is not a zero-sum game. The pie has grown tremendously over the past few decades, but we have not been able to share it fairly. Income differences continue to rise in many countries, and there's a dismal trade-off between economic growth and greater equality of income. Sustainable and inclusive growth does not happen by itself. The trickle-down effect does not exist. Wealth does not automatically trickle down to the poorest. So we can identify, and you also did that, Professor, many downsides to globalization. And I fully agree with you when you say they are not inevitable outcomes of economic laws. They are the outcomes of laws and agreements we make ourselves, or indeed we fail to make. To put globalization on the right track, we need effective government that tames, corrects, and regulates international markets. We need strong international organizations that are able to reach and enforce sound agreements about how international markets can serve society and not the other way around. International organizations also need mature international relations in which countries see and treat each other as equal partners. And this means that the West will have to make concessions at the negotiating table, make room for the new players from Asia, Africa, and Latin America. But change on this is really too slow. In 2010, for example, the IMF agreed on quota reforms. The Netherlands has done its bit, but the US is still refusing to give up any of its power. Now, this has to change. And I'm sure you agree, Professor. And the next line I wrote before last Wednesday happened. So I was going to call on you and say, please use your influence in Washington to help ensure this does change. And, you know, my plea is still there, but I'm not quite sure if your influence has risen over the last week. Anyway, you should do what you can, and we're behind you. Luckily, multilateral institutions did take steps forward, both formally but also informally. The OECD guidelines for multinational enterprises designed to foster corporate social responsibility, for example, agreements on tackling land grabbing, and many, many more. Another positive development is the fact that growing income inequality is getting very high on the international agenda. The World Bank, the OECD, IMF, World Economic Forum, and even The Economist, hardly a leftist newspaper, recently highlighted income inequality as one of the greatest threats to social and political stability. And Professor, you rightly point out that the ruthless market ideology of the Washington consensus has been discredited, and largely thanks to you. In sum, although we see progress in the area of global governance, there is still a long way to go. And I would say we will not achieve sustainable and inclusive growth at the negotiating table alone. We need more than laws, rules, and quota. Companies and citizens will also have to live up to their responsibilities. And as governments, we need to cooperate with them. And that is the basis for my agenda for aid, trade, and investment. And this agenda aims to respond to the new reality, a reality in which Asia, Latin America, and Africa are seeing huge growth in their share of global trade. And one of the driving forces behind this growth in trade has been the emergence of global value chains. Production processes have been cut up into different activities that take place all over the world. A country can take part in world trade with just a few activities. It no longer needs to set up an entire industry. Joining global chains brings new opportunities for development, but there are also risks. It's by no means certain that just a few activities will enable countries to boost their economy and climb up the global value chain. I think you, Professor, rightly pose serious questions about this kind of development strategy. You wrote that free trade forces countries to focus on activities that add little to their economic structure and learning capacity. No country has ever managed, in your words, to develop without some form of protectionism. And I'm sure this would be accurately reflecting your position. Therefore, I would like to argue that we have to make direct links between promoting trade and investment, between opening markets and between pushing a development agenda. Because countries can only benefit fully from trade and knowledge once certain basic conditions have been met. Without stability and peace, there can be no development. Without roads and ports, trade is barely possible. Without expertise, it's difficult to recognize useful knowledge, let alone absorb it. Aid often alleviates the most immediate needs, combats hunger, fights diseases, such as the terrible Ebola virus at this very moment. And in the longer term, successful aid also helps to remove obstacles to trade and strengthens preconditions for development. Let me give some examples, and one of the examples is on TTIP, so then I will also reflect on some of your remarks on that. But let me say first something on other trade relations, the trade relations between the European Union and Africa. When we make trade and investment agreements, we must not only agree on market access, but also on facilitating trade and transferring knowledge. And with this in mind, over the past year, the Netherlands has acted as an honest broker in negotiations between the EU and the African regions on economic partnership agreements. We brought parties together, kept the talks going. And last summer, the EU signed an agreement with ECOWAS, the Association of 15 Countries in West Africa. And small businesses like cocoa farmers in Ivory Coast will definitely benefit from the agreement because they can now sell their products more easily to the EU. The point I'm making is this. It's not simply a free trade agreement, because it explicitly takes account of the level of development of the countries involved. ECOWAS countries are given 20 years to remove barriers to trade in goods, and agreements have been made on aid to help create essential infrastructure and build institutions. The agreement also encourages regional integration and trade between the ECOWAS countries. Regional cooperation generally increases the learning effects of trade. It also creates a larger internal market and gives the region a stronger global position. EPAs have now been signed between the EU and Southern Africa and with East Africa. Then about the European Union and the United States and trade agreements. The agreement more commonly known as TTIP. Now, I can talk hours about this, which I usually do, but this time I'll take like 5 minutes. One, I think very important is that all of us, when we talk about trade agreements between the US and the EU and the negotiations, we try to demystify the whole thing by using language that we use in regular conversations. So we should not talk in acronyms, we should not talk in the typical trade language that no one else understands. We should just say what it's about, and it's about jobs. Okay. It's about more, of course, but it's about jobs and jobs and jobs. And I think the criticism that many of you, I think, and myself share on what could be the result of the negotiations, should not overshadow the economic importance of these kinds of agreements, because we need jobs. I hope all of you are in a job, but too many people are out of a job, and we should do anything to get them into jobs. This can be helpful, but not without taking care of some of the issues that also Professor Stiglitz has mentioned. Yeah, it's about non-tariff barriers, but should it be about a race to the bottom in terms of deregulation? No, it shouldn't. It should be about harmonizing. It should be about accepting each other's norms and standards instead of having to deal with double norms and standards. It should be about transparency, not only during the negotiation process, and we've been quite strong about that, but also after negotiation process is concluded. It should be, in my opinion, a mixed agreement where the European Parliament, but also national parliaments, should talk about. It should be about transparency during the negotiations. And here I think, ladies and gentlemen, Professor, there is a huge difference between the EU, the Netherlands on one side, and the US on the other side. And although I really appreciate my conversations with the USTR, as he's called, he has a name, this guy, his name is Michael Froman, I do tend to disagree with him on transparency and who are you going to consult. We typically also don't put on the table all of our negotiation input, because, of course, it's about negotiations with the Americans, so you should be, you know, you should watch your back. But we consult with civil society, businesses, citizens. Regularly, there's technical briefings to the parliament. Regularly, there's an update to the parliament that they might can't be able to share yet, but they need to be informed. So we want to be as transparent as possible. Because I also don't want to have any misconceptions because of intransparency. We might disagree on what this should be about, but that should not be due to lack of transparency. Now, this is really, I mean, this battle has not been finished, but I'm sure that the professor would be so kind to take my message to the States. Being the Minister for Trade and Aid, I, of course, am very much aware of what trade agreements in general, bilateral trade agreements of the EU with other trading blocs, can do to the position of developing countries. So I now commissioned a research to be done, not so much about how to minimize the negative impact of TTIP on developing countries, but on how to maximize the positive impact of an agreement like TTIP on developing countries. And you can imagine there could be some, because if you're a small-scale farmer in, let's say, Rwanda, then, and if you want to produce for the international market together with your fellow farmers in a cooperative, for example, you might need to have to address two types of regulation. And it could be very beneficial to you if you have one high standard. On ISDS, and then I'll finalize this block because we're getting derailed a little bit on TTIP, but on ISDS, the investment to state dispute settlement procedure, we have some worries too. And we have commissioned a research to answer basically the question, do we need an investment protection mechanism? And if we need one, is this then the right one, or should we modernize and change it? And we came up with 14 proposals to improve it. And I'll make sure, Professor, that you can... I already sent it to Mike Froman, but you can have a copy just for you. So this is about TTIP. And I do think that being able to combine the perspectives of the Netherlands, Europe, but also developing countries, we can make these trade agreements also beneficial to developing countries. Now, a second, third example. To achieve sustainable and inclusive growth, because that's what we want globalization to be about, companies must be responsible for their supply chain. Corporate social responsibility is on the rise. Businesses have little choice. The OECD guidelines demand it. The Dutch government is urging them in all kinds of ways to comply. But it's interesting to see that more and more business people have a much deeper motivation. If I ask Feike Siebesma, who runs Dutch chemicals company DSM, or Paul Polman, the top guy at Unilever, why they are keen to do business responsibly, they don't even understand the question anymore, because it's second nature to them. It's not an add-on, it's part of their primary process, and attitudes have changed and will be changing. The same, I would say, is true of local content, which is my third example, very relevant when it comes to foreign direct investments. Investments in a country have to have a positive impact on the recipient country. Building the shortest possible route, using your own firms and your own people to transport raw materials as efficiently as possible, does a disservice to your host country, and I'm convinced will eventually result in setbacks. Build the road in collaboration with local people, make sure that as many people as possible benefit from it, create jobs, as much spin-off as possible. Material and moral dividend will be huge. And once this idea on local content and how to responsibly invest takes hold, we can then do with fewer rules. Because sometimes we see that the very strict requirements on the local content of foreign direct investment can lead to shortages of local production factors and serve mainly to drive up prices. So we need to strike a right balance. My last example is about sharp intervention. Earlier I mentioned the collapse of the Rana Plaza textile factory in Bangladesh. And for almost 1,200 people, the race to the bottom in the textile industry ended under the rubble of a ramshackle factory. And along with the International Labour Organization, a number of other countries, civil society organizations, trade unions, and the textile industry itself, were working to make permanent improvements in working conditions. Safety inspections, better supervision should make workers safer. Longer contracts should give the industry some breathing space in this fiercely competitive global market. And it was competitive in earlier days already, like we just heard. Meanwhile, we are also keeping a close eye on developments in other low-pay countries like India, Ethiopia, and Myanmar. And I do hope that in a few years' time, we can conclude that together we found the path upwards out of the rubble of Rana Plaza. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor, let me finish where I started. Towards the end of the book, How to Get Filthy Rich in Rising Asia, the aging main character observes the world around him. And it sometimes reminds him of a dark value teeming with, and I quote, bony, mutating creatures, many of them carnivorous, that feed especially on the old and the sick and the frail. Not a pleasant image. To me, this is precisely the kind of dog-eat-dog capitalism that we want to, must to, and will rein in. Our hero at that age is unable to keep up, but he still recognizes one thing for sure, everywhere where he encounters it. Whether it's in the nice young guy from the telecom company or the confident young shop girl at the chemist's, I quote, "You are pricked by a lingering optimism and you marvel at the resilience and potential of those around you." It's change that he feels. He smells change, the scent of change. And it's the same scent that a lifetime ago, shivering and weak, made him crawl under his mother's bed and make something of his life. It's the scent of promise and hope. And here, I believe, Mohsin Hamid touches upon the very core of the debate on globalization, promise and hope. Because despite all the very serious and sincere reservations that can be made, that is the key. That promise and that hope can never be taken away again from the people of Asia, Africa, and South America. And even if we could take it away, we should not want to, because globalization carries a promise, and it's up to all of us to make that promise come through. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister Ploumen. Sustainable and inclusive growth doesn't happen from itself, as the minister said, and globalization can and probably should be better managed, as the professor brought in. May I invite you and also our moderator, Arnoud Boot, to take the floor. Arnoud?
Ladies and gentlemen, I see you have been sitting here already for 2 hours. So my proposal is that we do a little like this Dutch television show, De Wereld Draait Door. So we have to speed up. We have to be extremely clear in the discussion. No long monologues. We really would like to take optimal advantage from the presence of Professor Stiglitz here today. Before I start, before I start, and start with your questions. Professor Stiglitz, may I ask you to give a very brief rebuttal, maybe, or you don't want to call it rebuttal, to the minister, Minister Plamer. In terms of, if I would characterize it, and undoubtedly I don't do justice, trade, the Dutch approach to trade, aid, and jobs as a maybe very pragmatic approach. What's your response to the minister?
Well, I think, let me just say, I thought it was a wonderful talk, and I wish we had more ministers like that. So that who actually had read something and who had an awareness of some of the of these real challenges that we face. So let me just try to highlight two or three points. One of them is I think that we're much more aware today that from a development point of view, trade by itself won't lead to development. And that's why, for instance, in 2005, there began an important initiative called Aid for Trade. That if, trade, one way of thinking about it very simply is that the major barrier for a developed country selling its good abroad or, are the artificial barriers. But for a developing country, you have not only the artificial barriers, but you don't have roads, you don't have infrastructure, you don't have firms that can produce, you don't have capital markets. So eliminating the artificial barriers is only changing a small percentage of the problem they face. And that's why the experience has been that the trade liberalization has had limited benefits to development. That's why I really like the idea of trying to put together trade and development, of saying, look, trade, particularly with developing countries, ought to be thought of as a development instrument, but it will only work if there are other complementary things. Aid for trade is one. The notion of investment is another. One of the stories of the success of East Asia was that Japan sent many of its companies down, but the government played an important role, the Japanese government, in putting in the infrastructure so that it provided the public goods that the governments of the local economies couldn't afford at that time. So I think there needs to be this kind of the partnership, you might say, between the investment, the trade, and the development assistance. The second thing I want to say is when one thinks about investment and trade policy more generally, there are some kinds of activities that have more learning benefits and are more likely to lead to sustained growth. And that's one of the themes that comes across in your report on creating a learning economy. My book is about creating a learning society, but the idea is that there's limited learning spillovers from mindless assembly activities. There's much more learning from some other kinds of, say, manufacturing, higher value-added manufacturing. But this brings me to a third point, which is that some of the trade structures actually discourage the development of the higher value-added activities in many of the developing countries. This is getting a little technical, but there are things called escalating tariffs. Escalating tariffs mean that there are very low tariffs on the importation of raw materials, but higher tariffs on the importation of higher value-added processed materials. That is an attempt to preserve the colonial global division of labor. The colonial division of labor was that Africa supplied raw materials and they were processed in Europe. And now many of the resource-rich countries, including those in Africa, say this has to change. That They want to, the word they use is beneficiate. They want to take their raw materials and do some of the transformation. It makes sense to do some of the transformation right where the material exists. But unfortunately, the partnership agreements being signed with Europe and some of the other trade agreements restrict your ability to do this kind of beneficiation. One of the standard things is that, for instance, some of these countries would like to reverse the effect of the escalating tariffs and say a fraction of the raw materials have to be processed domestically. And at least some of the existing trade agreements don't allow that. And any minister concerned about trade and development ought to make sure that those provisions get struck out of the partnership agreements going forward. Let me just stop there and try to open it up.
Yeah, as a transition to your questions, I have to get used to the light, so make it very clear who wants to ask a question. Maybe as a transition. The debate in the last hour has been on the international consequences of globalization, particularly on the developing countries. In your talk, you are talking about equal opportunity, and that actually inequality might not be the problem, but equal opportunity might be the problem. And then you particularly look also in Western countries. Your belief in markets has been challenged. You believe in markets because that's what you have studied your whole life. I remember from all my economics courses, it was the problems that markets has and how you could solve these problems that markets have. And that was the focus of a lot of your work. You have made comments on the government basically being, let me use the word carefully, corrupted by money interests and no longer putting the public interest forward. So the solution may not come from the government in that sense. So your belief in markets exist is challenged, and your belief in the government is challenged. So how do we resolve this problem of equal opportunity? Because it is the government, it is society that has to preserve equal opportunity.
Yeah, so if I can try to put what you said in a slightly different language, if I understand, is that, you know, one of the things I've, you know, markets, I think, are very strong positive forces, but I've also described some of the limits of government. Economists refer to them as market failures. We usually think of the government correcting those market failures, but now, as we start looking at what has actually happened in many cases, governments are part of the problem as well as part of the solution. And then what is the answer? I guess I've become more and more convinced of the importance of civil society and thinking very carefully about the rules of government. And that's where, for instance, the minister's emphasis on transparency becomes important. But one has to think very carefully about some of these rules. They don't always have the effects that one seem to have. So let me give you one example where, the U.S. is trying to foist on Europe an aspect of American regulatory policy which seems on the face of it to be good, but has been disastrous. So we have a particular regulatory process where you propose comments, you propose a regulation, then you submit it in a very transparent way for comment, and then the regulator has to respond to the comments. And this is all part of what we call the rulemaking process. Sounds very good, except when you realize that who has the resources to make comments? It's the special interest, the lobbyists. They're sitting there with hundreds and hundreds of people. So you put a rule, most of the comments come from the vested interest. But then, this is where the political process comes in another invidious way. Congress makes sure that the regulator doesn't have the resources to answer. the comics. So then, I'll give you one example where this happened. In Dodd-Frank, there was one provision, civil society succeeded in getting it, a very surprising provision, where they said that a mining company or an oil company goes into a developing country, takes out the oil and minerals, has to disclose, make transparent all payments made to the governments. Obvious reason, they wanted to make sure that there was no corruption and that we were not complicitous in that corruption. Well, they got this amendment into the Dodd-Frank. There was a rulemaking, how do you do it? The mining companies, the oil companies, deluged them with comments. They answered the comments, but not in adequate detail. They came out with a good regulation. The oil companies sued in court, and the outcome was, meanwhile, the senators who had supported who had passed the provision said, the regulation is exactly what we wanted. It implements what we wanted, but the lawyers, who again are supported by the mining industry, oil industry, with unlimited, succeeded in getting the court to invalidate the regulation. That's what they want. They want U.S. is demanding that Europe adopt this system, which looks like a transparent system, but is a system that is really jiggered in such a way that the special interests always win.
Despite the fact that it aimed at transparency.
It seems to be aimed at transparency. Yeah. And the point I'm trying to emphasize is you have to look beneath the surface. Today, you won't hear anybody say, I'm against transparency. You know, the language we use, everybody today is in favor of equality, transparency, a sustainability, and everybody's learned how to use these words. So you have to dig underneath the surface and try to learn how people are using the words for purposes that are against transparency, against equality, against sustainability.
I'm going to look at the... Where's the question? Mr. Brinkhorst.
Thank you very much, Professor Stiglitz. I went to Colombia many years ago, and I think the spirit of Colombia is still very much with you. My question would be, do you still carry an American passport? But the serious question is, of course, we all agree with you. I mean, your statement in Europe has a lot of applause. I think basically it's a very European statement. But the question is, what can we others, Europeans and Chinese and others, do to have America change? Because you fundamentally indicated that it's not only economic inequality, but it's political inequality, and the system is very much biased in another direction. So what is your advice to us to make things change in your direction, not having, of course, the elections we had yesterday?
Okay. So first, in terms of I'm very critical about America, but I still have to use Obama's term, the audacity of hope. And so if I didn't have that hope, I wouldn't be so writing so much about all this. So it is out of the belief that there's still hope in the United States. But I do think that the rest of the world can have a very positive influence on the United States. There are many areas where the United States used to think of itself as having the best human rights, the best, and that we were the role model in all these areas for the rest of the world. Unfortunately, we're not. And Europe has been that role model in lots of areas. I mean, I could go through the list, but, just to give you one example of where we're at the bottom is our policy about incarceration. We have 5% of the world's population, but 25% of the prisoners. And you talk about a special interest. One of the reasons is that we have private prisons, and the private prison companies like this model. They're making a lot of profits. But by being an alternative, you know, think about the Scandinavia countries where they've managed to grow, and the average is gone, but so has the median gone up. And that shows that there's an alternative. But the more countries that are showing that there are an alternative, the more likely Americans will say, they say, oh, that's Scandinavian exceptionalism. You know, they look and say, there's something peculiar about those countries. And the more countries that are choosing other paths, I think the more persuasive it is for Americans who say, why are we living in this country that seems to be going a different direction from where the other democracies are going? Just to give you one other example, one of the most invidious aspects of our political process is, as I mentioned, this unlimited campaign contributions. For some reason, our Supreme Court believes that that's a necessary part of freedom of speech. And, you know, Europe, they have freedom of speech. I mean, I think most of you think that you have freedom of speech, but that you also don't have these unbridled campaign contributions, which actually distort our democracy. And that you, you know, democracy is more than elections every 4 years. It's about voice. And so that's the final part of my answer, is trying to create institutions that provide voice for more people is an essential part of the democratic process.
Yes, please stand up and maybe also give your name.
Yeah. Rolf van der Hoeven of the International Institute of Social Studies. In your exposé, you gave an indication of growing inequality because of globalization. We have seen that in the last 10 years, a number of countries actually inequality declined. Not much, but a bit. Latin America. But now, that was mainly on the tails of growing commodity prices. Now the commodity prices are going down. It's more difficult for these countries to reduce inequality. And so my question to you is, you have talked also about the international financial system, the international system. What is the one most important change in global governance that you would see that would allow the Latin American countries to continue with the decline in inequality? And that could help the policymaking, for example, in the Netherlands by voicing the position of developing countries in the international financial system and economic system. Thanks.
Yeah, I mean, that's a really good question, a very hard question. I mean, just for those of you who don't know, There have been really marked improvements in a few countries. Brazil, Gini coefficient, which is the standard measure of inequality, has come down about 10 points in the last 20 years. The result of deliberate policies, first under Cardoza about education, and then under Lula and a successor, having to do with all kinds of what they call conditional cash transfers, programs for health, food, education for the poor. Really been successful, and it shows that development policies can work in reducing poverty and increasing equality. One of the there are a couple policies that I think are important that can facilitate this, and these are more on the negative side than, you know, things that interfere with this. I think that one of the major impediments on the ability of countries to have an independent economic policy is excessive flows of short-term capital. Capital market regulation actually are important, not only for economic stability, but also for political autonomy. You see that very strongly in Brazil, where, because they're very relatively open, on a couple earlier occasions, every time Lula was about to win, there were two previous occasions he was about to win, Wall Street decided they didn't like him, and they pulled all their money out of the country, And the exchange rate went down, and everybody said, this is going to be a disaster. So it was the Wall Street bankers that were having more votes, in some sense, and more influence in the outcome of the election than the voters, than the people in Brazil. So you need to insulate yourself a little bit. It turned out, much to everybody's surprise, Lula was actually very good in macroeconomic management. So all those fears went, but the very fact that Wall Street seemed to have more votes than so much influence seems to me a real problem. And capital market, this openness in the market is what gave them that. Important to realize that you don't build factories on the basis of money that comes out in and out overnight. What you want to encourage is the foreign direct investment, the firms that come in to create jobs, the firms that come in and bring in technology, not the short-term capital. And that short-term capital leads to more financialization of the economy. And if there's a single correlation that's very strong, the degree of financialization of the economy is highly correlated with inequality. Jamie Gelberth has a very nice book that shows that. So the extent to which you open up your market for unbridled financialization, which is part of a lot of the trade agreements today, I think you expose yourself to forces that lead to more inequality.
Let's go to the back, totally in the back. Yes, is that microphone?
John Frost from the Dutch Central Bank. You mentioned earlier on the impact of QE on inequality in the US, so the Fed's quantitative easing policies. But the Fed is also now, among others, under Vice Chairman Stanley Fisher, back in the US, embarking on macroprudential policies. And I was wondering if you have a view on whether you think macroprudential policies would also affect inequality over time.
Well, I'm actually very supportive of macroprudential policies. These are policies, for instance, that try to stabilize the economy. So the old microprudential, we're looking at individual banks. The macro are things like policies that, when there's a bubble in the housing market building up, it says that we will require higher down payments relative to the value or relative to the income. Under Greenspan and Bernanke, we did just the opposite before the crisis. When the bubble was going, we fed the bubble because we said, oh, prices are going up, so you don't need to put down any down payment. And of course, that fed the bubble. So now there's a real understanding that you need to go the other way. In some ways, over the longer run, I think that will contribute to equality because it will stabilize the economy, and nothing has been as bad for inequality as the volatility, in particular the 2008 crisis. Even though it seems, and this is where, you know, to say that you have to have an 80% down payment on a house seems like it's hurting poor people who don't have any capital. The answer that I have is when you're poor, you may have to have a smaller house. And if the government is concerned about that, it ought to have a system of subsidizing income housing for poor people. And it could do it through the private or the public housing. But the way to deal with access to housing is not by creating unstable financial markets, which was the strategy that was done before. So,
but if you follow up on this, just very briefly on this question, you expressed this concern about capital flows. Yeah. Would these conditions on lending, which prevents you from lending against the bubble, would that not mean substitute for concerns about this free flow in capital? Meaning if Spain would not have been able to, the banks would not have been able to use that money to blow up the housing market, the capital flows would not have been a problem?
Yeah. Domestic regulation will dampen some of the unstable capital flows, but it won't be a perfect substitute. So it will, so I think, and I've been arguing, you need a portfolio of instruments. The extent to which restrictions on capital flows would be binding might be much more limited. So in a sense that you wouldn't, they wouldn't have to be as tight, there wouldn't be many as many instances where they would actually turn out to be binding, but they, you still need them because it, unfortunately, in the world we live in, there's a lot of irrational exuberance in the market, and when there's an irrational exuberance, they will find some way of coming in, something to bet on, and they will in that way be able to contribute to instability. By the way, the other point that these capital controls have is that they give more space for domestic policy in a whole variety of dimensions.
Thanks. Question, it's hard to see. With the red shirt, yeah. Jesus, wait.
Thank you. My name is Oltrumo, working for the Transnational Institute. We have been researching how, in the last years, the main policy response to the economic crisis in Europe has been the privatization of public services and destruction of social and labor rights. However, very little has been done on financial regulation, one of the problems that is embedded to globalization. And not only that, a great effort at the institutional level has been pursued on the TTIP negotiations. I would like you, Professor, to elaborate on what are those special interests behind TTIP negotiations, and if you will have a good strategy to name and expose those special interests. Thank you.
Well, you know, there are a whole variety of examples of on the special interest. The second example I gave in my talk was was about drugs, and everybody knows who the special interest there. It's the drug companies, and they don't like generics. I didn't have time to explain some of the brilliant ways that they are trying to squeeze the generics. For instance, one of the provisions they have with many developing countries is something called data exclusivity. Again, sounds very good, but what it turns out to be is the following, and this is just a rough summary, but if a drug company, I mean, the basic idea is if you come up with a generic that's equivalent to another drug, to show that the generic is safe and efficacious, all you should need to do is to show that it's equivalent to the drug who's been shown to be safe and efficacious. But the American drug companies say, oh no, if you do that, you're effectively using my data, even if that data is paid for by the US government, but it's my data. And therefore, they say, that's a violation of my property rights on the data. You can't do that. But then they put the developing country in a catch-22 position, or the generic in a catch. The standard procedures for testing safety and efficaciousness is against a placebo. But it's ethically improper to give somebody a placebo if you know that there exists a drug that's safe and efficacious. So they can't do the testing. So the brand name drug continues to dominate the market, and you can't bring in the generic. So that's a provision in a lot of the bilateral trade agreements. I don't know if they're trying to put that into this new one, but it's in a lot of the bilateral trade agreements that are really designed to deny access to, in fact, deny access to developing countries in a way that's more severe than even in the United States itself. So that's an example, but you can go through each of the industries and you can figure out that's not a secret. One comment I was going to make, and I can't really go through it in detail, the problem of the weaknesses in Europe, I mean, obviously have had a very high cost, and it's not been the subject of this talk, but I should say the problem isn't the structure in the individual countries' economies. I mean, always there's room for improvement. The real problem in Europe is the structure of the Eurozone. And that combined with the austerity policies that amplify these structural problems. So there's not going to be a recovery in Europe by a trade agreement. The only way you're going to get recovery in Europe is to fix the Eurozone. And when it comes to jobs on trade agreements, you have to remember trade agreements are about not just exports, but imports. And when the trade agreements are balanced, exports and imports are going to be both increased. And now, exports create jobs, but the bad news I don't want to tell you is imports destroy jobs. and so when it's balanced, you're not getting much job creation. Good trade agreements can be good if they're rightly structured because they allow for comparative advantage, and that can raise standards of living. But if you don't have, and this is particularly true for emerging markets, if your economy is not functioning, what you do is you get the job destruction from import liberalization, but you don't get any job creation, because you don't have capital markets that are working. And this is a real problem in Europe right now, because I mentioned in the United States that SME lending is 20% below the crisis. But if you look at the crisis countries in Europe, the decline in SME lending is an order of magnitude is much, much larger. And that's part of the structure of the Eurozone. So unless you fix that, there's going to be more job destruction than job creation.
You perfect foresight that my final question was on the Eurozone governance. You have focused on the globalization, global governance. You have managed Eurozone governance. My final question to you, to make you a little bit more specific on maybe how to fix the situation. What would your advice be on the Eurozone, considering also the reality of having different European countries, having heritage of the, in the different countries, the democratic legitimacy of the individual countries, what choices these people would like to make, given these constraints? So not an economist answer ignoring the constraints, with the constraints. How would you operate?
Okay, well, I can't answer the hardest part, which is how to manage the politics of the Eurozone. I mean, that's, and I wouldn't want to get very personal that you might want to have to get into. But let me say that I think the reforms that I'll describe in a second would be a benefit to virtually all the countries in Europe. So it's what economists would call is a Pareto superior. Everybody benefits. The only problem is not all of them perceive it that way. And that's the hardest thing to try to persuade people that it would be. So what are the major problems? Well, in terms of the structure of the Eurozone, one of the problems is that you created a system in which countries are borrowing in a currency not of their own creation. And we know what that happens. I mean, you get financial crises in the emerging markets over and over again. Now, what you manage to do in Europe is to bring an emerging market problem back to Europe. It was an amazing thing that you managed. Solidarity. There's a lot of solidarity that you should all suffer together, and and there are proposals of saying you should all jump over the cliff together, holding your hands. I think that there are better strategies. So one is something like the Eurobond. There are many institutional arrangements where you borrow together using the strength of the Eurozone. You know, the fact is that the US can borrow at -2%. The debt GDP ratio of Europe and the US are about the same. If you were borrowing with the collective strength, you could borrow at -2%. There are lots of good public investment projects that yield returns in the 5, 10, 20, 30%, particularly in technology, you know, creating a learning economy, all these things that were very high returns. A private sector, if you could borrow at -2% and you could invest at 20%, you would say you're stupid not to do it. But Europe seems to have the attitude that it doesn't want to do this, and I can't understand that. I mean, you know, this is beyond me. So that's one thing. It would some fiscal framework that would allow more positive joint fiscal activities like borrowing together, investing together in an expanded EIB. So that's one thing. The second thing, the single market, good idea if you buy the simple model of perfect markets. Capital moves all around. Just like I talked to before, free trade model, everything moves around very freely. We equalize wages so everybody gets the same unskilled wage as they do in India. Sounds great. But the problem with the single market is that we don't have a fully private financial system. Backing any country's financial system banks are the governments. You go back to 2008, 2009. Where did money flow? Remember, money flowed into the United States. It flowed into our banks. Did it flow into our banks because our banks have proven themselves really excelling in risk management? They had just shown that they didn't know how to manage risk. They had created the global crisis. But money flowed into the United States. Why? Because our government had said, here's a blank check for $700 billion. And if you need any more, we have a couple trillion dollars more in the bank. Don't worry. US Treasury and Federal Reserve are wholly owned subsidiaries of Wall Street. We'll give you as much money as you want. Okay, that's why money went there. But now, think of the single market. If you have your money in a Spanish banking system backed by the Spanish government, would you want to keep your money there or move it to Germany? Well, if you can't answer that, you shouldn't be having any money. So people move their money. But what did that do? At the beginning of Europe, there was a recognition that there needed to be convergence. But money was moving out of the weak countries into the strong. It was the single market promoted divergence. And so you had private sector austerity, if you want to think of that, contraction of lending in the private sector, augmenting contraction of spending in the public sector. And no wonder these countries are in depression. So what you need to do is have a single back. If you're going to have a single market, you have to have a banking union, which is more than common supervision. It has to be common deposit insurance, common resolution. So I could go on, but let me let me say on the optimistic side, these are not hard things to do. As you say, I'm answering a little bit as an economist, but the politics of this should be very clear. If you do this, all the countries of Europe are going to be better off. You know, Europe has the same resources, human, physical, natural resources today as it had in 2008. And you ask, why in spite of all these strengths, is GDP per capita in most of the country, in a large fraction of the countries in Europe, lower than it was in 2008. And the successful country, Germany, has growth that would normally be given a D, but it only looks good because the other countries are getting Fs. So, you know, and this is what you're boasting about, and it's based on a model that is not replicable. It says everybody should be exporting. Well, you know, again, I don't want to give you news. Everybody can't export. Trade with Mars is still limited. So if we're all exporting, where are we all exporting to?
Professor Stiglitz, thanks very much. The final word is for André Cornelius, as chairman of the WRR.
Thank you so much. Not much to words to add from my part. At the one hand, we are a bit late. At the other hand, we had some more minutes Stiglitz than we have ordered. And all these minutes were great. And I think we had a fascinating meeting with refreshing economic insights and new policy perspectives that you have presented. We had a good debate, very eloquent commentary from our minister. Thank you, Joseph Stiglitz. Thank you, Liliane Ploemen. Thank you, Arnoud Boot, for moderating the debate. Thank you all for being here and for participating. The thank you presents will be handed over after the session, and we invite you all to have drinks and share views and our feedback together. Yeah. Thank you so much.